Okay, so now coming to online instruction. The first thing is, before you begin a webinar, okay, anybody, the first thing you need to do is appoint a moderator. Okay, so for this session, Professor Sahana Murthy is the moderator. Why is this important? It's important because somebody has to keep track of the questions that are being posed on the chat. Somebody has to alert the speaker if the question needs immediate response and to pass the mic around in any interaction phase. Okay, as the speaker of the session, you know, your focus is on the content. So it's very difficult to focus on both things simultaneously. So when you do your course, one of the TAs of the course could be the moderator. The second thing is to keep reminding participants of the communication protocol, like we have been doing since the beginning. So please keep your mic muted and video off and speak only when the moderator says that it's your turn. And the third thing is share the presentation material beforehand. You can download both those files from the link that is posted in the chat window by me, and we can proceed. Okay, let me just say one thing about this talk. So I set out to make a 1 hour talk. Okay, and the talk kind of got away from me and it became a 3 hour tutorial. And so I couldn't bring myself to delete any slides. I thought, Ari, they are so much useful information. Okay, that is why what I've done is I've just hidden them for this presentation. So if you download the PPT file and see the hidden slides, then you can get the details of any point that is of interest to you. Okay, with that, let's begin with one activity. Okay. So consider your idea of online instruction. Okay, whatever it may be, whatever you may be thinking is included in online instruction. Now, when you move to online, which aspect of face-to-face classes will you miss the most? Okay, so I'm going to pause here for a moment. You can take half a minute to think about your answer and another half a minute to post your response in the chat window. So please look at the chat window and post what is it that you're going to miss the most when you move to online instruction from face-to-face classes. So I can see some responses going. Blackboard, personal interaction, eye contact, it's moving very fast for me to read, constant feedback, students' reactions, body languages, Blackboard, moving around the classroom, chatting with students, students' reaction, feel for how they are getting it, gauging how much they have learned, physical presence, body language, spontaneity and improvising, student questions and feedback, eye contact, walking around, interactions, excitement or the lack of it. Okay. Need to slow down, speed of teaching, group exercises, feedback from students about what is engaging and what is not. Okay, so that's quite a few responses that we've got. So maybe we can move on. There are a few more coming in. But I think many of them will get covered in the next few things that we are going to talk about. So now that you have given your responses, is your response similar to any in this list? You know? So making eye contact, many people have said, using gestures, walking around, I didn't see, you know, seeing students' faces to get feedback, you know, being able to adapt the instruction in real time, writing on the board, a lot of people have said, you know, being able to carry out step-by-step derivation, okay, interaction with students, doing Q&A, all of these are things that most of us think that we are going to miss when we move to online instruction. So let's see what really happens. So when we move to online instruction, actually making eye contact is possible. So when we move to online instruction, making eye contact is possible occasionally through a video call. Okay. Also using gestures is also possible, like you can do gesticulation in front of the video. I mean, of course, the space is not like huge, but you can do that. So, seeing students' faces, adapting in real time, let's see. Adapting is possible, but not in real time. Okay, let me do one thing. Let me just put up this entire slide so that you can take a look at it while videos are being turned off. So for those who are, you know, used to writing on the board, no, we need to now get used to writing on a tablet. Step-by-step derivations are also possible to show. You know, for example, many of us have seen the Khan Academy videos. Interaction is not just possible, but interaction is essential. Only the form of the interaction changes instead of, you know, having face-to-face interaction all the time. Now we interact through a forum. Okay, and there is a lot of power in that, which I will come to as we go along. Okay, doing Q&A is also again possible. Okay, so what is the difference? So a typical face-to-face is what we are used to. And this is our one of our LC rooms, LCH rooms type of area. So the instructor is doing the class in the place, and then the students go offline and they work on it or they don't work on it. And typically the split of the load is about 60% in the class and 40% in the out of class. So now when we move to online, what happens is that the out of class portion, the course materials actually become primary, you know, making them available anytime, anywhere, and often on any device. And the in-class portion, which is the instructor speaking, moves also to a live classroom kind of environment, like a Zoom meeting, which many of us are familiar with. And this becomes 70% of the asynchronous material, which students can access at their own time. And only about 30% is recommended that we do in the form of live interactions. Okay. So why is this? So why should we bother to change our way of lectures? Okay. What if we do? Let's say we go to a virtual classroom, like a Zoom meeting, and we do a live lectures with students who are able to attend. We have all heard that, you know, all students will not be able to attend, only those who are, you know, having bandwidth, etc. can attend. We say, okay, never mind. We'll just do the live class with them. And then we will use the meeting software itself to record the lecture. And then for those who could not attend the live lecture, we make the recording available. And we will use Moodle to upload the resources, give assignments, have discussions, etc. So what happens if we do this? Okay, so if we do only this, consider it from the student's point of view. So many students have access issues. Okay, they don't have smartphones. The device is often shared. They don't have access to come to the class. There's a lack of flexibility in the schedule. Many of them have to find the time. There's network issues. Like there is, their data plans are really not the same as the IITB corporate data plans. No, there are power issues in many places. So coming to the, expecting students will be able to come to the live classroom, that is actually not a reasonable assumption. Okay. The connectivity and access and affordability to network varies widely across our country. So it's not a valid assumption to say that, okay, students will have the same kind of access that I have. So you have to actually conduct a study and find out. So which is what the Manjunath committee is doing. And the second thing is, even if we upload it, if we say, okay, let them download. Okay, so the one thing that happens is the hour-long lecture and over a screen, there are two, three issues that happen. So one is it becomes a huge file for them to download. And again, the same network issues happen and you know, often they don't download it. And secondly, when the screen size is so small, and if you go on for an hour on that, the student engagement with the content becomes very low. So as a result of which, students don't usually watch these long lectures. Okay. So uploading of live sessions may be useful, but it's not sufficient because there will be glitches in the recordings, like voice break and frozen frame. For example, we are recording this particular session just, and we will be uploading it just for you to get a feel of, okay, what happens when we just only live record a session, how much distraction is there in that, which causes the students to lose attention. And then many students actually study for the test, right? Even short lectures, we have found, are not watched fully by most students. Okay, so there's a high variability in student motivation, and the highly motivated students are going to be able to study irrespective of what we do, right? So they will manage to come to the live class, they will manage to download, and they'll be able to do that. But then how many of those students are there in your class? That's the question that you have to ask. Okay, then there are network bandwidth issues, as I already mentioned. And finally, the point is that this lecture alone is not enough. We need activities for deeper engagement. I mean, this has been known for decades. Many of us are also implementing it, so it's not like a very new idea in that sense. So how to do these activities for deeper engagement in the online medium is the key question. Okay, so this more that we talked about of giving a lecture in a virtual classroom plus uploading its recording is something called emergency remote teaching. Okay. So what does emergency remote teaching actually mean? It means providing temporary access to instruction and materials that's easy for the instructor to set up and students can access it. So typically, this attempts to mimic the actions in a face-to-face class. And often, it's ineffective for student engagement and learning. So it's not like we should never do this. We should just use it sparingly. This mode should be used roughly, let's say, about less than 20% of the course. If we do in this mode, it's okay. Okay.